so many things coming out. Technology is progressing at such a rapid pace that people are actually complaining that it feels like time itself is actually speeding up. I mean, you can't really keep up with the amount of things that are coming out right now. And it's harder and harder when you read a headline anymore to even determine from the headline, is what you're reading happening? Or is it something they said they might be able to do? Is the headline that you're reading reality? Is it science fiction? Is there such a thing as science fiction anymore?
And when you're away, the smart feeder connects with the Nest Cam, allowing you to stay connected with your pet.
And he insists that this is not a way for the super wealthy to escape Earth should things go south here.
You can even watch this Choose Your Own Adventure movie, The Moment, which with an EEG headset changes the movie based on your brain-based reactions.
I mean, just in the past few weeks, you've got Microsoft workers protesting Microsoft because the company has a contract with the U.S. Army to supply HoloLens headsets so that the soldiers on the battlefield will no longer actually be on the battlefield, but instead will be basically in an augmented reality video game in their heads that the battlefield will be turned into. It'll basically be like Pokemon Go for war. And you've got scientists injecting nanoparticles into the eyeballs of animals so that they can see in infrared, which of course is something they plan to scale up and do in humans, because as we all know, science is only really awesome if we can use it to all become, I guess, X-Men or whatever we've been pre-programmed to accept. But creepier than that, you've got videos coming out of AI robot gods that are being installed in temples in ancient cities like Kyoto. And you have really creepy footage of people in robes actually bowing down to these robots. A robot AI deity that man has created with his own hands. I'm pretty sure there's a really, really old book that warns about this exact scenario, but it's happening. But this one right here, which came out in January, I've read it several times and I'm still not over it. Transhumanist science will free women from their biological clocks. Which is actually an underplaying if you read the article. This article is by Zoltan Istvan. If that name sounds familiar to you, it's because he was the transhumanist presidential candidate in the last election.
I'm a big believer that in the next 20 years, we're probably going to come to a point when we might actually be able to overcome human mortality.
Wouldn't mind living forever.
I know, and it's not just that, it's having better health. If you want to communicate in a different method, there'll be cranial implants, we'll have exoskeleton suits.
When they have anything to do with transhumanism and they want to get a quote from someone, they usually trot this guy out. And personally, I think we are way past the time where scientists should have looked down in their hands and said, just because we can do this, does it necessarily follow that we should be doing it? We're way past that moment. I mean, some of the stuff they're doing doesn't even make sense at the superficial level, the way that they're justifying it to the public. It doesn't make any sense. And this is one of them. But he starts the article off by decrying the seemingly unfair accident of human biology that is the inflexible window of female fertility. Otherwise, if you try to go beyond that, there's a lot of health risks involved. And how unfair that is, because men can just have babies in their 60s and 70s, and it's fine. So now we're going to use gene editing and combined with stem cell technology so that we can have older and older women have children and start families. And he goes on to say, in 2 decades' time, healthy 75-year-old women could be starting new families once more. Why should we be doing that? Why? Can someone please explain to me why we should be doing that at all? There's a reason why 75-year-old women don't start families. There's multiple reasons why that's a terrible idea and why we don't do that naturally. So why are they even remotely trying to act like this is something we should be doing? Why is science doing? People are starving in the streets. They don't have health care. There's just numerous issues going on. And yet, this is something science is going to be trying to do, is make 75-year-old women able to have babies. That is not something we need. We don't need that. In fact, it's bizarre that this is even coming out of the scientific community, because it's the same one that you get articles like this, which specifically say that age 75 is a good time to die. And they've even got charts in this article where they talk about how your burden on society and your creative potential and your contributions to society are pretty much downhill after age 60. So what's even the point? It really, it's an offensive article to all of humanity, this article right here. But on one hand, you have them telling the general public there's no point in living past the age of 75, while on the other end, they're talking about age 75 is a good time to start popping out kids. So which is it? It's a super mixed message, right? So that makes no sense at all. In any realm does that make sense, unless you're going to be part of some rich, wealthy elite like Sean Parker of Facebook talks about. Here's what Parker said, quote, "Because I'm a billionaire, I'm going to have access to better healthcare, so I'm going to be like 160, and I'm going to be part of this, like, class of immortal overlords." But it makes even less as you continue the article, because he talks about how they're working on this by converting skin cells into stem cells, which they can then turn into other types of cells, such as female eggs. So it wouldn't even be an actual egg anymore. Now it's a stem cell-created egg that just comes from a cotton swab swiped inside your cheek. And then you can get a donor sperm and mix that together and put that into a uterus. But wait, there's more, because he's also saying the skin cells could be turned into sperm too. So now we're to a point where not only does it not matter what age you are, but it also doesn't matter what sex you are. It doesn't matter if you are in a relationship. You don't even have to have another human being now. They're just going to swab someone's cheek, and that person is going to be both mother and father to the baby that they're going to create scientifically. But he then goes on to say, you don't even have to have a uterus either, because this guy wrote another article back in 2014 on what he called ectogenesis. It's about artificial wombs and how those are coming. And they've already been doing this with lambs. They were able to keep a lamb alive in one of these for a year. But take a look at the picture. They have babies growing in these egg-like sacks hooked to computers. It looks an awful lot like the movie The Matrix, which was obviously based on reality and not the other way around. So there's your predictive programming there. Look at this. I mean, nothing about this is human at all, except for the little baby in the middle of it. It's basically like a scientific laboratory factory hooked up to computers. It's the creepiest thing ever. And when I read it, it just reminds me of Aldous Huxley's 1932 book, Brave New World, that people would learn to love their servitude in a world where, for just one example, natural reproduction would be completely abolished and they'd basically bring up children in these hatcheries, which is a lot like what this looks like, this picture that they drew to show what ectogenesis is. They're saying in the future, a very large percentage of births are actually going to be done in these matrix-like egg pods, and how that's going to be really cool to do. And despite the fact that we live in a society where they try to tell everyone that until a baby is physically born and separated from its mother, it's just a fetus, they've done studies and they've shown that babies start to understand and be able to discern their mother's voice in the womb. So communication is already developing in there. They don't know, ultimately, what that's going to mean for a baby to be bred in some egg-like chamber instead of within the baby's mother or human being. They actually don't know what physiological and psychological processes they're going to be losing by removing that altogether. They actually don't know what effect that's going to have on that child for life. turning it into a cold, clinical, scientific experiment, basically, where they talk about the viability of your child and not really so much the humanity of it. They're doing all this stuff, and it's like they're just trying to play God so hard. He goes on to say they'll be able to use CRISPR and other editing techniques, and they'll be able to select for eye color and hair type. And in the future, they'll be able to create offspring with higher IQs, stronger bodies, possibly more advantageous psychological tendencies. In essence, designer babies, which is something we've been talking about on this channel for a while, the Gattaca future that they've been discussing for decades now. And so I guess it won't just be switching the biological clock off. It'll be destroying it altogether. It'll be completely unnecessary. It'll be going around it. There won't even be a need for anything. And they're going to turn it into a process about as emotionally engaging as picking out a new couch or a car or something. Well, I like the color red, and they're going to remove essentially almost entirely the entire human process from reproduction. That's the essence of dehumanization. So the transhumanist future isn't really about, they keep trying to sell it like it's about making humanity better, but it doesn't even sound like humanity at all. It sounds completely dehumanizing in every single way. And he mentions for a brief paragraph, two sentences, that there are risks because growing inequality could have terrible effects for humanity if these kinds of genetic editing advantages are available only for the rich. Well, you tell me who you think is going to be living so long that starting a family at age 75 is even something anyone would consider. It really does go back to those articles that came out in the last decade where they talked about humanity splitting off into two groups. But you're definitely talking about two very distinct types of human beings. And what's that even going to be like? I mean, you take this out to its logical conclusion, and you can see where films like Gattaca just aren't really that far off the mark.
Genetics, what can it mean? The ability to perfect the physical and mental characteristics of every unborn child.
Gattaca was considered a box office flop. It's the 1997 sci-fi film that's basically a cautionary tale set in a dystopian eugenics-run near future where people are genetically engineered.
You have specified hazel eyes, dark hair.
And controlled according to their genetic profiles. So in a world like that, a person's entire life, both professionally and socially, is determined by their genes. And thus, you have people that are essentially put into a technocratic caste system based on genetic discrimination and prejudice. So if you have really good genes, you get the best jobs in the most prestigious place in life. And if you have bad genes, you get crappy jobs and low status in society. They actually call the people with good genes in the movie valids, and the people who don't are labeled invalids. And people go watch these movies and they say, wow, that seems like a great science fiction plot. But it never really was truly 100% fiction. And the case has been made, and I think it's a pretty good case, that science fiction, a lot of what is passed off on society as science fiction, is actually really predictive programming. I mean, that's part of how the Collins brothers start their book, The Ascendancy of the Scientific Dictatorship, and they actually write that science fiction is thus a means of conditioning the masses to accept future visions that the elite wish to tangibly enact. And one of the things is pushing this idea that directed human evolution is not only preferable, but it's brainwashing everyone that this is inevitable, that this is where humanity is naturally supposed to be going, when there's absolutely nothing natural about any of this. And that is where the real wealth gap is going to be seen. That's where the real inequality is going to be seen. This Istvan guy brings it up for a sentence and then kind of just continues on arguing about how great this is going to be. But that sentence deserves a pause long enough to fill a whole book, because that's where the real inequality is about to come in this society, when you have a small segment of billionaires playing God with technologies, genetically engineering their offspring to be able to do everything better than everybody else. And I also just finished reading Michael A. Hoffman's Secret Societies and Psychological Warfare, which was published in 2001, but I have to say, if you have not read this book, it is more relevant now than when Hoffman wrote it. And it, I think, probably gets more relevant by the year. When I read this article, it immediately brought to mind this part in the book where he's talking about secret societies and what their ultimate goals are. And one of the things he specifically mentions is the rebuilding of the Tower of Babel. And in order to do it, they had to immerse the people of the West in an era that would idolize the material world and deny the spiritual world. And he writes, "Are you a career girl and need to postpone childbearing? Modern Sarahs will have children unto age 100, courtesy not of the God of the Old Testament, but of the God of the test tube. Are you a drunk who destroyed your liver? Pray for the death of a young motorcyclist or the execution of a hapless dissident in Red China, and you may have a new liver, or failing that, a hoo-hog liver. Are you a Parkinson's patient or a stroke victim? Relief is around the corner, courtesy of an injection into your brain of a needle containing cells taken from the corpse of a baby murdered in the womb, or from the body of a living pig man." And so it goes with a contumacious, carnival-like madness. Why is this depravity stronger and more lethal now in the 2001 epoch than at any other time in recorded human history? Because in the past, man could exculpate himself by pleading ignorance. But in the revelation of the method making manifest of all that is hidden era, man knows. Man knows.